I think we can start now. So then I'm going to introduce you in Spanish.
Thank you. Should I already start sharing my screen, or should I wait until you're ready with the introduction?
It's okay. It's fine if you can share your screen already. It doesn't matter. As you wish. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, buenos días. Gracias por estar en este seminario mañanero. El programa de Frontiers in Genomics, que es organizado por el Centro de Ciencias Genómicas y el Instituto de Biotecnología. Y en esta ocasión tengo el gusto de presentar a la doctora Marieke Quijer. La doctora Quijer es jefa de grupo en el Centro de Medicina Molecular de la Universidad de Oslo. Al mismo tiempo también es profesora asistente del Centro Médico de la Universidad de Leiden en Holanda, y es jefa del grupo de Biología Computacional y Medicina de Sistemas también en esa universidad. Marieke hizo su doctorado en la Universidad de Leiden en el 2008, y a partir del 2013 hasta el 2018 fue Research Fellow en el Dana-Farber Cancer Institute de la Universidad de Harvard, en Harvard Medical School. Como pueden apreciar, María, que es una investigadora joven, muy exitosa, y que en el poco tiempo que lleva siendo jefa de grupo ya tiene varios reconocimientos importantes, y simplemente voy a resumir algunos. Por ejemplo, obtuvo durante su doctorado el Erasmus Scholarship en el 2005, también el Dutch Cancer Society Fellowship, también el Leiden University PhD Award, y el premio Shan School of Public Health Program en Genómica Cuantitativa. Es editora de varias revistas, entre las que destacan Cancers y Frontiers in Genetics. Y el día de hoy nos va a hablar sobre Modeling Genome-Wide Regulatory Network in Healthy Tissues and in Cancer. Again, Marieke, thank you very much to be here with us. And now we are ready to hear your talk.
Thank you so much for the very nice introduction, and thanks for having me here. It's a pleasure to be here on Zoom. I wish, of course, it would be in person, but maybe we will be able to meet in person in the future. Mm-hmm. So I think I don't have to talk to you about the title, as it was just introduced. But basically, to kind of set a bit of a background on what my group is working on, I just wanted to show you a very quick, short example of what I think, or why I think we need precision medicine. So here we have two women, Sarah and Jane, who both have some symptoms. They have nausea, they experience seizures, and they don't go to the doctor. Now, they have different genotypes. They might work in different environments. Sarah might work in the lab, while Jane might be a gardener. And they might also have different ways of coping with stress. Now, both women, unfortunately, develop glioblastoma, a very aggressive form of brain cancer. And they're treated with the same measures, such as surgery, radiotherapy, and the same type of chemotherapy. Now, Sarah's tumor responds quite well to this treatment. However, Jane's tumor doesn't. And so with precision medicine approaches, what we hope to do is to understand why Sarah's tumor responds, but not Jane's, and hopefully then also develop new ways of treating Jane to make the treatment for her a bit better. And so I would like to talk about precision network medicine in this talk. So I hope I will be able to argue that networks are important in precision medicine. Specifically why networks are important in cancer. So my group mostly focuses on cancer, although we're interested in complex disease in general. But one of the things I think is very interesting about cancer is that it's so complex. So it's known that multiple factors play a role, both the genotype and the environment, as I showed you in the previous slide, and the disease is very heterogeneous. We might, for example, have different cancer subtypes that can be characterized by the expression of certain markers on the cell surface, or, for example, the activity of certain pathways, or patient prognosis. Now, in the past 20 years or so, it's been able to map these so-called omics landscapes to better identify cancer drivers or potential targets for treatment. And one of the projects that have been really key in mapping these landscapes is the Cancer Genome Atlas, where multiple types of omics data were mapped, such as mutation data, expression data, copy number data, etc. And through the analysis of these different data types for different cancer types and also in pan-cancer approaches, we've been able to understand cancer a little bit better and a little bit more in depth than previously. However, these studies have also found that cancers have really complex genomes and many alterations, and they are very heterogeneous. And for a large number of cancer patients, we can't always point to, for example, specific drivers of the disease. So I believe that it's important to not analyze these single data types, but actually also look into interactions. Because due to the complex nature of cancer, what's really important is to model these interactions and their rewiring genome-wide. And I'll be mostly talking about regulatory interactions in this talk, but you can also potentially think of other types of interactions here. Of course, to model interactions in a genome-wide way, what we need is to have integrative tools that can integrate these different types of omics data, and that can help us both model and analyze networks, ideally for individual cancer patients. So this is going to be an overview of my talk. I will start with this general overview on what I mean with gene regulatory networks and some different types of approaches of inferring or modeling these networks. I'll then show you a study where we modeled transcriptional networks. So we looked at how transcription factors regulate target gene expression levels with this method that we call PANDA to model networks for individual tissues and then to better understand tissue-specific gene regulatory differences. After this, I'll shortly introduce you a method that we call PUMA, that is an extension of PANDA that can model post-transcriptional networks. I'll show you again some examples, both in healthy tissues as well as in a form of bone cancer. Now, after having introduced these two approaches, I'll be talking about single sample networks with a method that we call Lioness. And then finally, I will combine these different approaches to model networks in cancer. And I will specifically focus on brain cancer in this talk. And I'll end with some conclusions, as well as some current and future directions, highlighting a couple of the more recent approaches that we are currently developing in the group. So what are gene regulatory networks and how can we model them? And why do we need to model them? Well, it's of course known that human cells carry out many common processes, for example, processes that define cell survival or cellular structure. But cells also exhibit these unique functions that can help define their phenotype. And while all of our cells have almost exactly the same genome, different tissues can arise from this. This is really driven by so-called gene regulatory processes. And here you can think of, for example, transcriptional regulation, which is mainly driven by transcription factors that can bind to regulatory regions, for example, specific transcription factor motifs in the promoters of their target genes. And also, for example, through post-transcriptional regulation. And you can think here of microRNAs that inhibit the expression of target genes, as well as RNA binding proteins. Now, these regulatory processes define which genes are expressed, and they also control the timing and extent of that expression. And so what we believe is that they form a complex of interaction or network of interactions between regulators and their target genes. So, for example, as I said, transcription factors and their target genes. And this is what is called a regulatory network. And these networks are different, for example, for different tissues, but they might also vary, for example, over time or through development. Now, it's important to realize that disruption or rewiring of these processes can actually drive disease, also cancer. So, for example, if you have a transcription factor that's highly overexpressed, this might rewire this network and this might drive cancer. But you can also think of an edge in the network, so here an interaction, which might, for example, be a transcription factor binding site that is mutated and that allows other types of transcription factors to be recruited and thereby change this network and drive cancer. So how do we model these networks? So ideally, what we want to do with these networks is to try to capture all potential regulators, for example, all transcription factors in the human genome and all of the target genes that are regulated by these transcription factors. And then if regulation is happening, if we know, for example, in a specific cell type or specific cancer cell type, there is regulation driven by this transcription factor of this target gene, we would draw an edge in this network. And we would ideally do this for all possible combinations so that we can get a genome-wide estimate of gene regulation. Now, it's possible to get these networks through experimental approaches. You can think of ChIP-seq experiments where you look at where a specific transcription factor binds to the genome, or, for example, luciferase reporter assays for microRNAs. The difficulty here is that these experiments are very expensive. You essentially need to do one for each regulator. So the human genome has over 1,000 transcription factors, so this is getting expensive really quickly. And it also requires lots of material. So while this is feasible to do in cell lines, it gets more complex when you, for example, want to study a specific cancer's biopsy. Another approach to infer these networks is through computational network inference. Now, many different methods exist that try to model networks. Many of them are based on the concept of correlation. What they essentially do is they take the regulator's expression level across a data set, for example, a microRNA, and see how this expression varies across patients, and then correlates this with target genes. And if there's an anti-correlation for the microRNA, we can think, well, this microRNA might maybe downregulate its target genes. Some other methods start with some initial network. Here you can think of, for example, a transcription factor motif scan, so known binding sites of transcription factors. And then they color these nodes based on the expression levels in a specific data set or sample. This is something we call network painting approaches. But we found these two methods to be a bit, to not be very complete, because we found, as I'll show you in some of the next slides, that correlation doesn't always mean regulation. So you might miss out interesting interactions if you only look at whether a regulator's expression level correlates with its target genes. And also these approaches, for example, this network painting approach, is not able to capture any new or potential non-canonical interactions because you limit yourself to the search space of this initial network. Now, we've been working with a method that's called message passing that tries to combine different data types for the regulators and their target genes and integrate these. And I will show you how this works in the next slides. So the idea of message passing is basically to try to look at information flow in a specific data set. And here what we're interested in is information flow between transcription factors or microRNAs and their target genes. But to highlight how message passing works, I just wanted to show you this short example of a very small classroom where we have one teacher and two students. And the teacher is trying to explain an equation to these students. However, if the teacher doesn't do a very good job, the students will likely fail their exams. Well, if the teacher knows how to explain these equations, the students might get better grades. So this teacher is responsible for teaching. They are trying to send a message to the students. Students also need to be available to learn. If they're not paying attention, they might get not that good grades on their exams. So these terms, responsibility and availability, come from this message passing approach. And essentially, what we try to do here is, instead of now having a teacher and two students, we will look at transcription factors that try to send a message to the target genes, so the students. And because we have many, many transcription factors and can look into their interactions, and we have a large search space, a large set of students of target genes, and can look at their interactions as well, we can actually measure where the message passing works and where it breaks down. So we do this with a method that's called PANDA. It was developed by my collaborator, Kimberly Glass from Harvard Medical School. It stands for passing attributes between networks for data assimilation, and it works really well to model these gene regulatory networks. What Panda does is it starts with three different input data sets or input networks. The first one is the center one here. It's called the regulatory prior, and it can, for example, be derived from a transcription factor motif scan. So some initial guess of whether a transcription factor can actually bind to the promoter of its target gene. Then we have protein-protein interactions, so interactions between transcription factors. And then we have co-expression information of the target genes. So our target genes being co-expressed or not. Importantly, this method is different from some of the methods that I showed you before, in the sense that it doesn't look into the expression levels, so it doesn't look into the mRNA expression levels of the transcription factor to model these interactions. Instead, it's going to use message passing to look at overlaps between targeting profiles. So basically, what this basically does is it assumes that two transcription factors that bind together, so transcription factors often form complexes and they work together. So if we have two transcription factors that bind together, they're going to have similar or regulate similar sets of target genes. And in addition, if you have two target genes that are being co-expressed, they're going to be likely be regulated by similar sets of transcription factors. So message passing is an iterative approach that slightly updates this initial network based on the other two data types, and then loops through this many, many times until the network converges. We then have one network that has found agreement between these three different data types, and that is a measure of gene regulation in the specific data set of interest. And I will show you obviously some examples in the next slides. But just a little bit about the output of the method. This method is a model's complete network. So you essentially have measurements for each transcription factor and each target gene in your model. And these networks are weighted. Edge weights represent likelihoods of interaction. So the higher the edge weight, the more likely an interaction is in that particular data set. Of course, these networks are really big if you model them genome-wide. So if we have about 650 transcription factors and about 30,000 target genes, as we had in some of the examples that I'm going to show you in this talk, you have networks of about 20 million edges. So they are very big. They're obviously not easy to draw. This is not an example of a 20 million edge network, but probably a much smaller network. So we need to have computational approaches to also analyze them. So let's look into an example of applying Panda now to better understand tissue-specific gene regulation. So for this project, which I carried out together with my collaborators Abhijit Sonawane and Kimberly Glass when I was still a postdoc in the Quackenbush group at Harvard, we basically were interested in modeling these transcriptional networks for different tissues. And we decided to use this GTEx dataset that came from the Genotype Tissue Expression Project because it was a very rich dataset to model these networks on. So we had data available for almost 10,000 samples representing a little over 50 tissues. We ended up analyzing 38 of these tissues after some normalization approaches, and then used Panda and integrated this expression data that I'm showing you here with protein-protein interactions, in this case from literature, so from the string database, as well as a transcription factor motif scan based on published motifs of transcription factors. So we had 38 networks available, and we then wanted to compare them. What we specifically wanted to look into is into these edges, so the interactions. Can we identify any tissue-specific interactions in these networks? And we were also interested in the nodes, so the transcription factors and their target genes. And we wanted to see how do these nodes and edges relate to one another. What we used for this was actually a very simple score. So basically, we had 38 different networks. Now, what if you're interested in brain? So this network over here, what you can do is you can look into a specific edge weight and then compare this to the edge weight across all 38 tissues. We used a very simple metric for this. We basically just subtracted the median edge weights across all 38 tissues from this edge weight in brain and then divided this by the interquartile range. So this is kind of an outlier analysis. And as you can see, when you do such an approach, sometimes you can actually have edges or interactions that are specific to more than one tissue. Just because they are highly abundant in two tissues, for example, and this is and but very lowly and stably expressed or abundant in the other tissues. And this is something we call the multiplicity. So in this case, you see these two very high edge weights. We call this a multiplicity of two. And we saw this actually quite a lot for example, different brain regions. So we studied three different brain regions in total. And so then we often observed that there were edges that were specific to these three different brain regions compared to all other tissues. So we looked into the multiplicity levels and the number of edges in all of these tissues. And what we found, first of all, is that these numbers were quite different. So for example, we had to, in this bar plot, we basically just showed a number of tissue-specific edges that we measured in these networks. And for example, in testes, we found so many tissue-specific edges that we had to draw this on a different scale. So this was actually not very surprising. The testes has also very different gene expression patterns compared to other tissues. And then we also saw that the multiplicities were also a bit different. But interestingly, we found a lot of edges that were actually only specific in one tissue or maybe two, here shown in blue. This picture looked a bit different when we looked into genes and transcription factors and their multiplicity levels. So first of all, there is not really a one-to-one relationship between the number of edges identified and the number of genes and transcription factors that were tissue-specific. But importantly, genes and especially transcription factors had much higher multiplicity levels, here shown in these orange colors. So nodes have higher multiplicity than edges. We then did a couple of enrichment analysis to try to better understand how these things connect together. And what we basically found is that transcription factors are less likely to be tissue specific and have higher multiplicity levels, as you can also see in this figure. And we found that tissue specific edges are enriched for binding or connecting to tissue specific nodes, but they were much more enriched for connecting to tissue specific target genes than to tissue specific transcription factors. So essentially what we see is we might have a gene that is specific, maybe in two tissues, but then what we see is that there's a highly tissue-specific interaction here that might be driven by a transcription factor that is not specifically expressed in that tissue. So that might have stable expression across all tissues. This is, of course, not very surprising. We're looking at mRNA levels of transcription factors here. Obviously, these transcription factors have to be translated into proteins. They have to be activated, et cetera. But it was nice that we could capture this with these networks. So transcription factors do not have to be differentially expressed themselves in order to regulate their target genes. And we actually need these network models to better understand the connections between transcription factors and their target genes, and to also be able to highlight specific transcription factors that you might not immediately identify when you just look at their expression levels. This is something we also did through an analysis of what we call transcription factor targeting profiles. And to show you how this works, I'd like to draw these networks in so-called adjacency matrices, where we basically have the transcription factors here on the x-axis and then the target gene on the y-axis, and then in between all of these different edge weights between them. Now, what if you're interested in a specific transcription factor, say NeuroD2 in brain, and what are the biological functions that it regulates in brain? What we can do is we can take this vector of edge weights that connect to this specific transcription factor and compare it to these vectors of edge weights across all 38 tissues with a very similar formula as what we used to identify tissue-specific edges. Now, what I really liked about this analysis is that we can then do gene set enrichments analysis on these differential targeting profiles to better understand the function of these transcription factors. And we can obviously do this for all transcription factors and even for all tissues, and this is what we did, but I'll just show you the example in brain for simplicity. So here you see the tissue-specific targeting that we observed in brain, with in red high enrichment and in blue under enrichment. What we first of all saw is that there's many pathways that make sense in brain, for example, neurotransmitter secretion or axon guidance. But what we also found is when visualizing the transcription factors based on their expression levels, whether they were tissue specific here in black or not tissue specific here in gray, we found that there are actually quite some transcription factors that regulate these important pathways in brain, but that are not differentially expressed in brain. And zooming into this a bit more, now drawing the top 10 tissue specific transcription factors here in black and the 10 least specific transcription factors here in gray, we found that there's obviously some transcription factors that are tissue specific, such as NeuroD2, that regulate these functions. But there are also many transcription factors that are not specifically expressed that do regulate these functions. And upon literature check, we actually found that all of these four transcription factors that are not specifically expressed in brain, but that do regulate these functions, all play are known to play a role in, for example, brain development or neuronal cell death or neuronal differentiation. So it seems that we can actually highlight these important transcription factors by putting them into the framework of a network. We also analyzed the target genes. We did use some network metric approaches to better understand if we could highlight tissue-specific genes. We could. I'm not going to show that in detail, but basically we can use these large-scale network models to find these important drivers of tissue specificity. So now let's move on to post-transcriptional regulation. We basically wanted to extend this PANDA method to model networks for microRNAs. So microRNAs are small RNAs that can bind to the 3' UTR of their target transcripts. And microRNA gene regulation is very complex. Basically, the human genome has over 2,000 microRNAs, and they can bind to multiple microRNA binding sites per gene. And they can also bind to non-canonical regulatory sites. So this is definitely a difficult or complex network that we could study. Now, in developing PUMA, which stands for PANDA, using microRNA associations, we wanted to use this message passing framework. What we basically did is we started with, instead of a transcription factor motif scan, we used microRNA target predictions from well-known resources as an input network, and then we combined this with co-expression data. However, for this part, the protein-protein interaction, we made some changes, so we adapted the message passing to account for the differences in transcriptional regulation and post-transcriptional regulation. Transcription factors are known to act in complexes, but microRNAs do not, so we adapted the message passing framework to account for this. Now, we used this GTEx data again to test this method. One of the things that we were very interested in was to better understand, can we actually model networks reproducibly, even if we use different target prediction resources? So here we modeled networks based on two resources. So we modeled one set of networks on target scan and one sort of set of networks based on predictions for Miranda, two very well-used or widely used target prediction algorithms. And we could then compare these networks. We basically essentially used these tissue specificity scores as well, and then drew them for the different tissues. And here you can see the number of tissue specific edges for the target scan networks and for the Miranda networks. They're pretty comparable. We also found that their multiplicity levels were very comparable. So PUMA seems to be able to consistently capture tissue specific interactions. We also used these targeting profiles for all microRNAs in all 38 different tissues and compared them. And what we found is that these targeting profiles are quite similar. So here you see a similarity score. We just used Pearson correlation. Everything that is higher than maybe 0.5 could be thought of as a consistent targeting profile. So basically here, if you use target scan or Miranda, it doesn't really matter for these microRNAs. You find the same functions that they regulate in these specific tissues. We also made this available as a resource through a Shiny app, and the link can be seen over here. Finally, we integrated this with a MIRD SNP, a data set or a database where you basically have SNPs in microRNA binding sites. And through evaluating the functions of those genes, as well as the functions that we predicted for these microRNAs to be affected in the tissues, that the diseases that these microRNAs were involved or these SNPs were involved in, we found that there was similarity. So it seems that PUMA networks can actually highlight potential disease associations. And now kind of to move on towards the patient-specific network analysis, I just wanted to show you an application of PUMA in a cancer type, osteosarcoma, which is a primary bone cancer that's highly aggressive. And so basically, as my collaborator, Dimitris Spensas from Harvard Medical School, had identified a specific region on chromosome 14q that contains a cluster of microRNAs that could predict osteosarcoma recurrence. So Dimitris was very interested in if we could use PUMA to identify target genes that were regulated by these microRNAs. Now, the difficulty here is in the GTEx studies, we had 38 different tissues. We could compare one network with all the 38 networks. But here, we only had two groups. We had a low-risk group consisting of about 18 patients and a high-risk group consisting of 19 patients. So we could only model two networks, a low-risk network here in blue and a high-risk network here in red. And obviously, it's difficult to compare these networks. You can look into differences in edge weights, but you cannot really perform any statistics on these. So what we decided to do is to permute the sample labels in these data sets. So we basically modeled these networks on resampled data. And that way, we could compare our high and low risk networks or weights in these networks to this background data set, and get things like p-values and correct for multiple testing to identify edges that were significantly different between these two different groups of patients. What we found is when looking at the network of genes around these five microRNAs that my collaborator had found that were present on chromosome 14q, we found that they targeted genes involved in osteoblast differentiation and DNA damage, two very well-known pathways in osteosarcoma. But something that I was very excited about is that when we zoomed into the top significant edges, these were connected to two different microRNAs, we could found that there were, first of all, there was often an inverse pattern of regulation. So as I showed before, PUMA doesn't really take into account the fact that microRNAs often downregulate their target genes. We don't look into correlations between microRNA expression and the target gene expression. But the model can learn this. So we found, for example, let's see if I can find this tumor suppressor CD9 that was highly expressed in the low-risk subgroup and lowly expressed in the high-risk subgroup. And you can see this edge here is red, meaning that the edge weight was high in the high-risk subgroup. So this indicates downregulation of this tumor suppressor in the high-risk subgroup. So this was a nice finding. So let's move on to the patient-specific network analysis. So I kind of already gave you a bit of an idea why we actually need patient-specific network models. With these aggregate models that you model with, for example, PANDA and PUMA or other network reconstruction approaches, you can model these condition-specific networks, for example, for a high-risk and a low-risk osteosarcoma risk of recurrence group of patients. But you cannot really statistically compare these networks. You can compare disease with control or two groups, but you cannot perform any statistical analyses on these networks. And of course, if we want to move towards personalized medicine approaches or network medicine approaches, we would ideally have networks for individual patients. A workaround that has been used in the field a bit is to start with an aggregate network model, for example, modeled with PANDA. And then for each individual patient, just color these nodes in these networks based on the expression levels in that specific sample derived from that tumor. However, as I just showed, we found that a regulator's expression level often does not correlate very well with its targets. So you might miss up some interesting interactions here. And of course, this approach does not directly model edges. So you, when you model an aggregate network model, you will not be able to learn any new edges that, for example, might derive from a mutation in a transcription factor binding site. So we needed a new approach. And for this, I worked together with Kimberly Glass, the original developer of PANDA, to develop this approach that we call Lioness. And Lioness works on a actually very simple concept. So as I showed you in this talk, we can model a network with, for example, PANDA if we have a group of patients, say a group of osteosarcoma patients. for which we have gene expression data available. Integrated with protein-protein interactions, the transcription vector motif scan, use message passing in Panda, and then we get this network that has been estimated using all samples in the population. But we thought ourselves, what happens if you remove one patient or one sample from this initial data set? It turns out that the network that is estimated on all samples except this sample Q, the sample that we removed, is going to be a bit different. So pulling out a sample perturbs the initial network. And we can make use of these differences to get back to the individual's patient-specific network. I'm not going to show you this in detail, but basically this is a linear equation that we found can actually mathematically derive based on simple methods such as Pearson correlation or mutual information, and that also works with large, more complex methods such as Panda. And we tested this method in different data sets. We had in silico data, we had microarray data that came from yeast cells that were synchronized and that then went through two cell cycles. And we also had human cell line data available, where we essentially had replicates and where we could also look into chromatin states to validate our network models. And I'm not going to show you here the details because I think the application of Linus is actually more interesting. But what we found was that these networks are reproducible. So we could capture, for example, for technical replicates, networks would cluster together and they're accurate. So for example, in the in silico data, we had gold standards we could compare the modeled networks on. And they were also biologically meaningful. So for example, in the data where we had yeast cells, we found that network edges actually oscillated throughout the cell cycle. And since developing the approach, it's been around for a while actually already, we've applied it in different settings, one of which I'm going to show you today. But I just wanted to mention that the method itself, even though we like to use it together with Panda to get these, or Puma to get these regulatory networks, it is not limited to regulatory networks. So you can use it with other network approaches as well. And I was very excited to see this, that this approach has now also been used, for example, to look at co-occurrences of different microbiota. So let's apply Linus to model networks in cancer now. And now I'm going to focus on glioblastoma. So glioblastoma is a very aggressive form of brain cancer. The 5-year overall survival rate is very low. It's about 5%. Now, in the past, some prognostic signatures have been published, actually many more than the ones that I'm showing you over here. However, these signatures were often inconsistent, so not many genes overlapped between them. This is one of the reasons why we wanted to use glioblastoma as a model to apply Linus to, because we were wondering, might there be some differences in terms of gene regulation that can predict whether patients have better or worse prognosis. However, another reason we picked this as an application for our Linus approach was that multiple data sets were available for network modeling. So we took data from the Cancer Genome Atlas. We analyzed microarray data because what we kind of liked about this data set is that there were two different platforms, or two different microarray platforms available. About 500 patients were profiled on each. And so we had this gene expression data, and when we then used Panda and Linus to integrate this with a regulatory prior, as well as protein-protein interaction data. And these prior data sets were very similar to the ones that we used in GTEx before. So we essentially could model two collections of individual patient networks. And then we wanted to analyze them. And we basically were interested in survival. So what we did is we divided this patient population up into actually three groups, but we only analyzed the long-term and short-term survivor group. There were some censored patients that we didn't include. So we used this 20-month threshold. If a patient survived more than 20 months, we put them in the long-term survivor group. And if a patient didn't, we put them in the short-term survivor group. So now we had these networks available, and I'm just showing you this example how this network analysis would look like if you wouldn't have Linus. So here I'm still modeling condition-specific networks with Panda without Linus. So if you do that, basically you can look at some edge weights. So here we have edge weights in the long-term survivor group ranging from some negative score to some positive score. Same for the short-term survivor group. And what you can do is look into edge weights that are, for example, high, so higher. So these are these weights are kind of similar to z-scores, so we generally take weights that are higher than maybe 1.28, and then the weights shown here in blue are higher in the long-term survival group, and the weights shown here in red are higher in the short-term survival group. But as I said, we cannot really do any statistics on these. We can also look into something that we call gene targeting scores, or when you talk about networks, this is often called the degree. So in this case, the gene degree, where you basically sum up all of the edge weights that point to a gene. And this is kind of a general estimate on how much is the gene regulated by the entire set of transcription factors in the cell. When we look at targeting scores, we see that there are some differences. There are actually a bit of outliers here that you could look into. For example, we see that, what you basically can do is you can check at these genes, and you see that there's, for example, a gene involved in mTOR signaling or a gene involved in cell cycling that is highly, it has a high score in the short-term survival group. However, when we then did gene set enrichment analysis on these differential gene targeting scores, we actually didn't identify any significantly enriched pathways. So now let's take a look on how this works if you have Linus, so if you have a single sample network approach. So now we use Panda and Linus, model networks for these two groups of patients, and then again, compare these gene targeting scores. What we now can use is approaches to statistically compare these scores. So we use methods that are have been developed on gene expression data, so linear models, and we can correct for covariates such as the patient's age, the patient's sex, or potential neoadjuvant treatment status. We can then perform gene set enrichment analysis to identify the pathways that are differentially or significantly differentially regulated between these two groups of patients. And what we found here is that we actually did this for these two different data set we had available for TCGA, and we found that the pathways that were consistently significantly differentially regulated all played a role in immune signaling. So we had, for example, PD-1 signaling, toll-like receptor trafficking, or complement cascade. This figure basically shows the enrichment score, so how strong is the effect size of this enrichment analysis, and then the log FDR in terms of the color in the bubble. And we have two bubbles, one for each data set or each collection of networks. Now, we repeated this entire analysis in an independent data set. We found some data from the German glioma network that had about 70 patients. We modeled the networks again, performed this LIMA analysis, and what we could then find is that we could capture one of these seven pathways, and this was PD-1 signaling. This was higher regulated in the long-term survivors, which we also saw in the original data from TCGA. We also analyzed some data from primary and recurrent tumors and also found that this regulation of this pathway is higher in the primary tumor compared to recurrent tumors. Now, this figure shows a network of edges that are the network of edges around genes that play a role in this pathway. We essentially see that many of these edges are blue. That this means they're strong in the long-term survival group. And then the target genes are red, meaning that they're overexpressed in the short-term survival group. So this seems to be repression. Now, we wanted to be sure that this signal was not due to differences in immune components. And so what we did was we used some deconvolution approaches. Here I'm showing you the results from Excel, but we actually also used CyberSort X for this to see, are there any differences in terms of immune component between these two different patient populations? And we didn't find any. So this seems to be a signal that is present on the cancer cells. We also didn't find any association with mutation load, which we measured with a tool that we have in a group that's called SAMBAR. So it seems that the repression of this pathway is an independent prognostic biomarker in glioblastoma. And now we hope that potentially targeting transcription factors that play a role in this pathway could revert the PD-1 signature to its repressive state and help this group of short-term survival patients. So this brings me kind of to the example I had in the beginning, where we had these two different patients, one of whom responded better to treatment than the other. Now that we can analyze a tumor and look at the network of regulatory interactions around this, we can actually find the differences that might drive these differences in response to treatment, and hopefully then design better treatment options for these patients who didn't really respond to the standard regimen. So this brings me to my conclusions and as well as the current and future directions of the group. So I hope I convinced you that to better understand complex disease such as cancer, we should really shift from analyzing single data types to modeling the complex network of interactions. PANDA and PUMA are two tools that can model transcriptional and post-transcriptional regulatory networks, and LIONESS can model networks for individual patients that allows us to statistically analyze or look into network rewiring. And we used PANDA and LIONESS to identify a loss of repression of PD-1 signaling to be associated with poor survival in glioblastoma. So this is kind of an overview of what my group is interested in studying. So we look into these complex regulatory interactions through condition-specific network modeling with approaches such as PANDA. And we're very interested in looking into how disruptions of these networks might drive cancer, as well as using individual patient network modeling approaches and then using those for precision medicine techniques, potentially looking at clustering patients based on their networks to see can we identify new subtypes for different cancer types, as well as looking into how they might respond to different treatments. So we have some tools that recently were mostly focused on genome-wide network inference. But then we are currently focusing on expanding a bit, both on trying to get better ways of doing these comparative network analyses. These networks are really big and there's many things you can do with them. So that's one direction we're taking. We are also interested in combining these networks with other types of multi-omics data, expanding these approaches to newly emerging data, such as single cell or potentially spatial transcriptomics. And then of course, applying these tools to different cancer types. And we're mainly focusing on breast cancer, sarcomas, and pan cancer approaches at the moment. So kind of to wrap up the talk, I just wanted to show you a few of the other tools that we are working on that are currently in progress in the group. And one of these is a K-MEN, a tool that has been developed by Ping Han, a PhD student in the group, that helps normalize input data to model your networks on. So what Ping Han found is that certain normalization methods, in particular smooth quantum normalization, can introduce actually false positive associations in networks. And this is mostly found into very heterogeneous data, such as data from GTEx or data from the TCGA, where you have many, many different tissues. And he found that this is due to sample-specific normalization of tight counts. So for example, if you look here at gene expression data, so this is co-expression of different tissues in GTEx. Here we just use four tissues that are, and in these here we specifically visualize tissue-exclusive genes, so genes that are only expressed in one tissue but not in the others. We found a lot of co-expression that shouldn't be there. And also, if you analyze this data in terms of a network, we found a lot of edges that actually shouldn't be there. So Ping Han developed an approach that we call K-MEN that basically uses a Gaussian mixture model to fit the expression distribution and then adaptively find thresholds to identify and remove lowly expressed genes that have basically values that have been introduced by the normalization. And he found that this approach works quite well. It removes false positive associations. So this can potentially help in getting us better network models. Another approach I wanted to show is Porcupine. This is a tool that has been developed by Tatiana Belova, a postdoc in the group, that helps us better understand networks on the edge or pathway level. So this project kind of came about when Tatiana analyzed pan-sarcoma data. From the TCGA, there's seven different sarcoma types available. And we were very, we wanted to see if there were any potential new subtypes in these sarcoma data types, in sarcomas. So Tatiana analyzed both expression data and networks for these seven different sarcoma types, and she could basically identify two potentially new clusters in this data set. These are shown over here. So this is a clustering based on the networks, and what Tatiana found is that there seems to be two new subtypes in leiomyosarcoma, a form of smooth muscle sarcoma, that does not very well correlate to the known subtypes in leiomyosarcoma. So through analyzing this, Tatiana was a bit frustrated with what we call the gene degree. I mean, you just look at the genes, but these networks are much more complex. Can we do something more interesting here? So she developed this porcupine approach that essentially allows us to measure this heterogeneity in a patient population on the pathway and edge level. And it works as follows. I see my animation is a little bit slow. Yeah, there it comes. So what it essentially does is it takes a specific biological pathway and all the genes in it. So for example, you can think of PD-1 signaling, take all the genes that play a role in PD-1 signaling, and then take all the edges from the individual patient networks that connect to this pathway. So here we have a matrix of edge weights, and what we can then do is perform principal component analysis on this data and see like how much variance is actually explained by the first principal component. Now to see if this specific pathway, say PD-1 signaling, is significant, what the method then does is it generates a null background of sampled, resampled pathways and then compares the amount of variability explained by this first principal component with what you get when you do this on these resampled data sets, and then checks if this result is statistically significant. So through applying this method on the leiomyosarcoma data in TCGA, as well as in data from our collaborators, Tatiana identified quite a couple of pathways that are differentially regulated and that kind of are involved in driving the heterogeneity in this patient population. And what we can now do with these pathways, and this is just an example of one of the top pathways we found in a of replication initiation of damaged DNA by RB1 and E2F1. What we can then do is look into these target genes and check how much they are actually involved. So how much are they differentially regulated across this patient population, as well as identify the top transcription factors that are involved in driving differential regulation of this pathway. And we're currently, so this is still work in progress. We currently try to validate this actually in the wet lab. So we basically matched networks. We modeled networks on cell lines and then matched these two networks for biopsies, so for patients. And we could find that cell lines also exhibit this heterogeneous gene regulation. So we can potentially use them to check, hey, is this pathway actually differentially regulated between, for example, this cell line and this cell line? So this is still work in progress. This is something I just wanted to quickly highlight. We have a tool that was already published a few years ago that basically looks into somatic mutations in cancer. So it's a bit different from networks. But one of the things we wanted to do with mutation data is to use it to see if we could identify new patient subgroups based on their mutational profiles. But we had some challenges there because mutation data is very, very sparse and also very heterogeneous. So we came up with this method that we call SAMBAR that basically desparsifies mutation data into pathway mutation scores. So you essentially get a mutation score for individual pathways and can then use that for clustering your patient population. We did this actually on all 23 cancer types that were at the time available in TCGA and could identify, for example, prognostic subtypes based on the mutational profiles in three different cancer types, as well as some pan-cancer subtypes, so mutational subtypes that are different across different cancer types. And we've also been happy to see this method is now being picked up in some other studies as well. And finally, I think it's about time to wrap up, but I wanted to show you this new approach that we call Reindeer that was developed by Daniel Osorio, a former postdoc in the group, who wanted to see, can we actually use data. Oh, I think, I'm sorry, I think I hear some sound from someone. Could you please mute your mic? Thanks. So basically, Daniel wanted to see if we could use, so this is also not really network approach, but more an approach where he wanted to use data from the connectivity map, where you have lots of cell lines that have been perturbed with lots of different drugs. And for these cell lines, there's expression data available. And he wanted to see, can we combine this with experiments from single-cell RNA-seq to predict new drugs and potentially new drug combinations for cancer? So he developed this approach that basically integrates the data from this connectivity map and models kind of time-independent, concentration-independent, and disease-specific drug signatures. And applying that, combining it to with data derived from single-cell RNA-seq from breast cancer as well as healthy breast tissues, he basically compared the single-cell expression profiles in triple-negative breast cancer cells to single-cell expression profiles in breast cancer or not breast cancer cells, healthy cells that had hormone receptors all that were essentially triple positive, to see if can we predict any drugs that could potentially revert the signature of triple negative breast cancer towards these healthy and hormone receptor positive cells that could then potentially be treated with standard hormone receptor inhibition. So he developed this approach. He identified two different kinases that could be potentially used. One is, for example, a pan-AKT kinase inhibitor that can revert these triple-negative transcriptional signatures. And he could also show that there's, if you would use this in these triple-negative breast cancer cells, there's these several pathways, for example, TNF-alpha signaling or mTOR signaling will be affected. So that's basically the mechanism of action of using this inhibitor in triple-negative breast cancer cells. So with that, I would like to end. This is just an overview of the group's tools. So I've showed you all of them today, I think. I just wanted to mention this network zoo that was developed by Tian Wang and Marwan Ben-Gabilla, a postdoc in John Quackenbush's group, my former lab where I did my postdoc. That basically is a collaborative effort where a lot of collaborators with the Quackenbush group publish their tools. So there's, you can not only find Panda, Puma, and Sambar, but for example, other tools as well, such as Alpaca or Spider, that are tools that take that do different things with networks. For example, network community detection or integration of epigenetic data with networks. So with that, I'm very grateful, of course, to my team. I showed you some work from Tatjana, from Pinghan, and from Daniel today. I'm also very grateful to all of my collaborators. In particular, I showed you some work today from Ebiji, Sonawana, from Kimberly Glass, Camila Lopez-Ramos, and of course, John Quackenbush. And thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Maria Kevin. Very interesting talk. So now the seminar is open for questions. So you can raise your hand in the application, or you can put your question in the chat. And I think there's already several questions in the chat. There are three questions, I think. You want me to read it for you, or you can read it, Maria?
I can read them, that's fine. So I think the first question is, what requirements must our computers meet to use Panda and Puma? This is a very difficult question because this depends what type of networks you want to model. So I think the main difficulty, so these networks are obviously big. So if you want to use model genome-wide networks with 600 transcription factors and 20,000 target genes, we generally, it depends a bit which algorithm you use as well, because we have different versions of it. We have an R version, a Python version, a MATLAB version, a C version. So it depends a bit what version you use. But I like to use the MATLAB version because it's fast, but it takes up lots of memory. So it's for these genome-wide networks, it might take maybe 40 gigabytes of RAM. So we do that this on computer clusters. So it depends a bit. The C version is less memory intensive, but it's very slow. So it takes more time to run. But it's possible to do it on maybe on your laptop as well. So it depends a bit. It also depends on how big the networks are that you want to model. So if you are interested in, I don't know, maybe Drosophila, there might be fewer transcription factors and gene you might want to analyze, then it's going to be a bit easier. You would need fewer computational resources to model the networks. So it depends a bit. I would just suggest to try, and then if it crashes, you know, you might need more resources. Or contact me. I'm of course very happy to help out.
Okay. So the second question is related. I think you already answered that.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
Can you say computer laptop or we need a cluster? You already answered that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
So then the next question is Esperanza Martinez.
So it says, would you consider that proteins could be better markers of outcomes in cancer like glioblastoma? So this is a bit difficult. We haven't really looked into proteins that much. I think in general, gene expression is very stable, or it's at least a very nice technique that is very reproducible. I'm not sure how that's with protein abundance levels. It might be a bit more difficult. But on the other hand, I know that for example, what's often done in cancer is that you use these immunohistochemical stainings where you essentially look at, are certain proteins expressed in a cell? And that's actually very powerful because it's a standard technique in the clinic. It's used by pathologists to, for example, diagnose certain cancer types or to check if they express certain proteins that might respond to treatment. So I'm not sure in glioblastoma. I'm not sure if proteins are better to better markers of outcomes or not. Could be. So the next question is, a tissue has distinct cell types. Yes. How do you deal with that in transcriptomic analysis? Yeah, absolutely. So what we've been using a lot up till now is these bulk analysis, where we generally use publicly available data, such as data from TCGA. And we've been working a lot with bulk tumors, so then you obviously have different cell types. And this can be a confounding factor. So one thing you can do is first use, for example, these deconvolution approaches, or maybe some data that's already available on different immune cell types, for example, to try to correct your statistical analysis. But then something, what you can also do is what I showed in the glioblastoma example, is you can use these deconvolution approaches to check afterwards, like, is the signal that we found actually, does it actually come from tumor cells? Or might it be possible that we just found this because there's a difference in terms of cell types? Obviously now with single cell RNA-seq, it's possible to get into much more detail, and that's something that we're slowly moving into. Ah, there's a question in Spanish. I think maybe.
No.
It was about the microphone. Okay.
Is from Gustavo Pedraza. That's also in the chat. Is the next one?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So let's see. Regarding your last example, where PD-1 signaling defines survival length, how do you explain these differences? Do microRNAs play an important role, or is it better explained at the gene expression level? Yeah, so we actually did these analyses. I just showed you the example in glioblastoma because this was the first study we did, but we're actually looking into other cancer types from TCGA as well now. And we find that sometimes, and we actually see PD-1 signaling pop up a lot. This is really recent work. but what we see is that sometimes you can see this in expressions, or sometimes the expression, just the mRNA levels are enough to predict survival. Sometimes the networks are, and sometimes both are. So it depends a bit on the cancer type. So I think definitely regulators such as transcription factors and microRNAs play a big role. But sometimes it's already possible to see these differences at the gene expression level. But we have some examples where it's not possible to see this at the gene expression level, but where we do see the differences in terms of gene regulation. And a really nice example is the study I didn't show today, but that was done by Camila López-Ramos as well, where she looked into sex differences in colon cancer. And there basically she found that certain pathways that play a role in drug metabolism are actually differentially regulated by men and women, and this directly associate with survival. So women who had high regulation of these pathways responded much better to chemotherapy than women who had low regulation of these pathways. So this is an example where we didn't really find much in terms of just gene expression levels in itself, but we did find this pathway when we analyzed the networks. Python version, I see, is the next question. But I cannot see, I don't see, I see there's two more messages.
No.
Oh, okay. So there is a Python version of Panda and Puma as well. Probably the best place to look is the Network Zoo, because that's being updated a lot. So that's probably the best way to look into Python versions. Yes. Let's see. Next question. Have you tried applying the studies with these programs to other chronic degenerative diseases such as Parkinson's and Alzheimer's? This is really nice. Actually, I have a postdoc who's very interested in Alzheimer's disease. So she plans to run a patient-specific network analysis based on a very large Alzheimer's data set. We don't have any results there yet, but it's definitely possible. I'm very excited to look into that as well. But we have most expertise on cancer, so it's a little bit out of my comfort zone. Thank you.
Okay. I have a very specific question. It's very, mm-hmm. very specific.
Okay.
It's about transcription factors and when you analyze it using Panda. So mm-hmm. I wonder if you analyze with me, and if is that the case, I'm curious to know, to see how the network looks like with me. And this is my question is because one of the hypotheses of the role of me in cancer, and actually there are a lot of new data that supports this hypothesis, is that the role of MYC in cancer actually is just to increase the transcription of all the genome, of all the genes that are expressed in that particular cell type, even with autosomal RNA. So it's why I wonder how MYC could be.
So I think that's a very interesting question. So something we could look into is maybe look into a cancer that has a high like mutation rate in MYC. Or high amplification, and then compare patients who have this high amplification with patients who don't, to check if there's any regulatory differences. We haven't really done this at this point. I mean, there's so many things you can look into, right? With all these transcription factors, like where do we start? We generally take this data-driven approach, so we just model networks and see what comes out. But these targeted questions are very interesting. And this worked out really well for the osteosarcoma microRNA analysis, where we actually knew the microRNAs we wanted to look into. So it's, yeah, that'd be definitely interesting to study.
Okay. Well, there's no more questions.
Thank you, everyone. I see some people are happy. Can Panda be used in any organism? Yeah. So what you need is a transcription factor motif scan. You can build this yourself if motifs are available. So we like to use JASPAR a lot. It's a database that my collaborator here at NCMM has developed. And they have motifs for many different organisms. And then Kimberly Glass, who developed Panda, also has a lot of ready-made motif scans for different organisms. So for mice, bacteria, yeah. One of my colleagues, John Pladik, from Harvard, he has been modeling Panda networks in tuberculosis. I hope it's a bacteria.
It is.
Very small genome, really nice networks to work with. And he could actually also show that Panda network, he could basically find transcription factors and actually validate the activity of transcription factors through looking at are they activated through phosphorylation. So he could He has a nice study in that. I don't remember exactly where it was published, but if you look for tuberculosis in John Pladdock, you will find it. How can these methods be used in order to predict drug response? Yeah. So one thing I didn't mention, it's not exactly predicting drug response, but it's predicting drugs. That's really nice is this tool that has been developed by Marouen, postdoc in the Quackenbush lab. So he basically modeled networks for all these different experiments that were done in cell lines, where basically they had expression data from this different cell lines, and then also drug response to many different drugs. And so basically this is data from the connectivity map as well. So he basically developed a tool that allows you to, once you did your network analysis and you identified genes that are up or down targeted in your networks, you can match this to these cell line data to see, hey, if my network looks very similar to some known network that has already been profiled in a specific cell type that responded to specific drugs, it's likely that you have a bit of more evidence that drug might also work in the disease that you're studying. So that's one thing. This is part of the a paper that was recently published a few months ago in NAR. So I'd be happy to share that with you as well. The website is called Grand Network Medicine. So he basically, Marouen, developed this big resource where we can put our networks. So the glioblastoma networks that I talked about today are in this database. But then he also provided this new resource of networks modeled on these cell lines. So if you're interested, grandnetworkmedicine.org, I think.
Okay, I think that's it. And well, Marieke, thank you very much. It was a very interesting talk. And I'm sure there's going to be people that is going to contact you after that.
That'd be great. I always love to get in touch. So please do.
Yeah, and hopefully next time we'll be in person. And well, thank you.
Thanks a lot. This worked really well on Zoom, and I would love to visit, of course, but I'm very happy to do it this way as well. It's been really nice that we can so easily get in touch this way.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone, for the nice questions.
Okay. There's a lot of messages in the chat. Thank you.
Yep. That's very nice. Okay. Thanks so much, everyone.
Okay. See you.
Okay, bye-bye.